In the realm of data compression, there's been many rulers over many lands of information. But since the early days of the realm, there's been one family that's reigned over it with supreme authority. This ruling class is known as the Lempel-Ziv family of compressors, and it's got bloodlines that span generations, with feuding brothers and sisters and cousins, and even twice removed aunts. A family tree that's so dynamic and interwoven that it makes Game of Thrones look like a gathering at a local pizza parlor. No, this family is more than that. It's cunning and dynamic and efficient. Traits that have allowed it to reign over the realm of compression for more than 30 years undisputed. But to truly understand what gives this family its power, we're going to have to go back and change the way that we approach our data and challenge our fundamental understanding of entropy. Now, this is going to be a difficult task, but fear not, young programmer. I'm here to help. My name is Colt McAnlis, and this is Compressor Head. What Claude Shannon developed with the concept of entropy was a measurement of information content in a stream, or put another way, entropy defines the minimum number of bits needed per symbol on average to represent your data stream. So for example, you take the entropy of a stream and multiply it by the length of the stream, and you get the smallest size that stream can be compressed according to information theory. But there's a reason it's called information theory, not a law. We can break the rules. So for example, if we took this sorted, linearly increasing numbers as our data stream, the entropy is about 4 bits per symbol. However, if we apply delta encoding, which is the process of encoding the next symbol as the difference with the previous symbol, we end up with a data stream full of ones, whose entropy is effectively zero. Now, what we did here was transform the stream into something with a different symbol frequency, dominantly ones, which changed the entropy, making it more compressible. This idea, to transform data into state which can be better compressed, lies at the heart of all modern compression theory, but it's not as straightforward as it seems. So for example, take the stream of ones and twos. Applying a delta transform here doesn't change the frequency of the symbols. The entropy remains about 1 bit per symbol, give or take a quarter of a bit. As such, we know that not every data transform is suited for every type of data. You need to know something about the data in your stream to properly understand what valid transforms work on it to produce lower entropy, which, trust me, is a lot trickier than it sounds. Now, if we focus the eye of Sauron on compressing textual data, we find that one of the more popular transforms is known as symbol grouping. You see, up until now, we've really only been looking at single symbols within a stream, but in reality, there's often quite a lot of correlation between adjacent symbols. For example, you typically see the letter Q followed by the letter U. Grouping symbols means looking at the stream in terms of pairs or more of adjacent symbols instead of just the single ones. Guys, my clicker's broken. Thanks. So for that example data set, you can see that by grouping the symbols together, a new pattern emerges, which of course, as we know, changes entropy. But sadly, we don't get a chance to look at compressed data manually. So writing a grouping algorithm gets tough when you get complex strings. But just for giggles, we're going to take a swing at this one anyway. Are you taking a selfie? Just turn the thing. So if we simply define each letter as a symbol, as we have been doing, we end up with an entropy that's around 2.38, which isn't that bad for a string like this, but I think we can do a little bit better. Can we speed this up next time, maybe? Actually, looking at this stream, we realized that probably words or known words would be a little bit easier to group by. So for to be or not to be, for this stream, we get a little bit better entropy at 1.98, which is much, much better, but I think we can still do more. Now we're getting it. In fact, a naive approach may be to do something a little bit different. Perhaps we should actually take the longest string that can be matched. So in this case, to be or not is actually matched twice in this string, and it actually has the longest length. The problem here is that we actually end up with a whole group of single symbols that really don't have any duplicates and no clear skewed probability. And the entropy reflects this at 2.5. You see, what we really need is more of a dynamic grouping algorithm, one that tries to find a balance between the longest chains and the smallest entropy. And as you can imagine, that's a pretty difficult problem. Thanks. Really? Let's just go to the next scene. And with that in mind, it's time to reveal the founders of the LZ dynasty. You see, back in 1977, right after an accident took them out of running for the Winter Olympics, Abraham Lempel and Jacob Ziv invented an algorithm which identifies the optimal way to tokenize a stream. The original two transforms, named LZ77 and LZ78, are so good at finding optimal tokenization that in 30 plus years, there hasn't been another algorithm to replace them. Nope, the LZ family still makes up the backbone of all modern, useful compressors. The LZ algorithm works by splitting the stream into two segments. The left side of the stream is dubbed the search buffer and contains the symbols that we've already seen and already processed. The right side of the stream is denoted the look ahead buffer and contains symbols we haven't seen yet. In practical matters, the search buffer is some thousands of kilo symbols long, while the look ahead buffer is some tens of symbols long. The encoder will read a symbol from the look ahead buffer and attempt to find a match for it in the search buffer. If the symbol is found, then the encoder will go to read more symbols from the look ahead buffer and continue searching backwards in the search buffer until it finds the longest match. When a match is finally settled on, the encoder will output a token. The token has three parts: an offset, a length, and the next token in the stream. In this case, it would be 9 backwards from the window with a length of 2 symbols, where the next symbol in the look ahead is the letter B. Once this is done, the window is then shifted to the right. If the backwards search yields no match for a given input symbol, or we're seeing a symbol for the first time, instead of outputting a token with length and offset, we actually output a null token, which is 0, 0, and then the token itself that we actually just encountered. The compression process comes from creating lists and lists and lists of these token values across the entire data set, and then combining each of the channels in their own associative lanes to create compression. Now that we've actually been through encoding, it's time to meet the rest of the family. At the top of our tree lie LZ78 and LZ77, our matriarch and patriarch algorithms. Each one has given rise to a variant that changes just slightly how you search through your search buffer or how you output tokens. For example, LZW will actually maintain a running variable length dictionary of symbols, always trying to optimize for the longest match possible. LZSS, on the other hand, will not emit a token if the token itself is longer than the string you're trying to compress. Or my favorite, LZMA, actually combines the LZ algorithm with Markov chains to produce better compression. In fact, LZMA is actually one of the cooler algorithms of this entire tree. Not only is it more modern, but it actually combines a statistical encoder with the LZ transform. And in fact, most of these algorithms do not compress as well as you would think, and need statistical encoding to actually get the values you want. In fact, if you look under the hood at most modern compression algorithms, you actually see an LZ variant sitting around. For example, LZW is actually the backbone of PKZIP, a popular compression algorithm in the early 90s. On the other hand, LZSS makes up most of what WinRAR uses. And this deflate algorithm over here, you may recognize it. It powers everything behind GZIP, which runs most of the internet right now, or you may know it as a better name, of WinZIP, which of course is the Windows variant of that. And of course, my favorite, LZMA, actually comes from a modern archiver known as 7-Zip that's slowly gaining popularity. The truth of all of this is that LZ is such a dynamic and efficient algorithm that it powers the backbone of the fastest, most used archivers out there in the public today. Even if something else comes along, the LZ family's reign is going to last much longer than you and I realize. In the realm of data compression, the LZ family still reigns supreme. It's the backbone of the most popular and aggressive compressors out there. But there's trouble in the realm. A new breed of algorithms known as the Markov models are actually threatening its reign. But that's a story for a different show. My name is Colt McAnlis. Thanks for watching.